Welcome to episode 7 of season 6 of the podcast, and today we're honored to be joined by Wallace Raghu. I hope I'm saying that right. And he is the owner of Hood Gym in Nairobi. He is a bodybuilder. And yeah, as we were just discussing, we have been trying to plan this podcast with him for over a year. So
he's been too busy.
He's a man of talents.
Also, I don't think that introduction gives him quite enough justice, because he's a welder, he's a gym owner, he's a bodybuilder, he's a trainer. You know, he does all this stuff. He makes gym equipment, you know. He's done a bit of everything.
Yeah, I do a bit of everything. Like, I'm a jack of all trades, you know. You have to do that here to survive.
Definitely. Another trait.
So welcome to the podcast, Wallace. And maybe you can just start by, telling us a little bit about yourself, your background, how you got into bodybuilding, and all your trades.
So as you have already heard, my name is Wallace Raghu, and I started training back in 2006 when I was still in high school. And one of the reasons, there are many reasons, like maybe four reasons why I got into bodybuilding, but one of the reasons was because I kind of had big calves, you know, and then small quads, and then of course the upper body was small. So a guy, when we were in form two, introduced me, he told me, you know, your calves, you look nice, your calves, but man, your arm is like too small. Of course, it had a small peak there, but it was just small. So because of that, he introduced me to the gym, and we started lifting together. Lifting concrete, and then from there on I joined another gym. In fact, it's my dad who paid my first session, because he saw that I was lifting stones there, and then he asked me, there's this one afternoon you are watching, there was a I don't know if you, especially Leon, if you remember a program by Lihani on Sundays afternoon on Family TV. Yeah. You remember that?
Yeah, the gospel. Sure.
Yeah. I was watching that with my dad, and my dad was like, Wallace, do you think that one day lifting these stones you lift outside there, can't you find a gym where there's proper equipment so I can like pay a membership for you? And that's what I did. In fact, I already knew there was a gym somewhere, but I didn't know that my dad would like pay for a subscription for me. So when he told me that, it was on a Sunday. Then on a Monday, I went to school, came back, and I was like, I don't think he really meant it. But as I was changing my uniform, he told me, hey, Wallace, what are you doing, man? Let's go to the gym. Let's go, show me where you... I didn't even remove my uniform. So we went there straight. When we reached there, the gym was like around 400 shillings. Then he talked to the owner. I told, hey, this guy is a student and he's just a beginner. Can't you charge him half of that? The guy was like, okay, just get in. And that's how I started. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a first story I think I've heard where someone started the gym without a sports background. Because for me, it was the opposite. I told my dad, I need the gym. And he's like, so you can be too heavy to run on the field. So it's nice to hear a very different story.
And nice that your dad supported you.
Yeah, man.
I was going to say, your dad obviously spotted with good genetics for next league.
Yeah, I think so. And he also has a good genetic. He has never lifted, but he's just 5'6", like me, but with a very long chest, like all the way almost to the stomach here, a very long chest, you know, it's all about muscle bellies. He also has he has a nice shape, I mean, even though right now he's old, but... If I show you his old photos when he was working somewhere in Mombasa, then they used to go to the beach. You can see, you'll think it's a person who used to lift weights, but no, he didn't. Yeah, he never lifted weights. Although right now I'm trying to get him to lift.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In the gym.
That's where you got the genetics come from now, you know.
Yes, I believe so. And some, of course, from my mother because of the calves. like she's slim, but the calf is big. It's even bigger than mine.
Oh,
when you're walking around, women walking around with those big calves, or a random guy who's skinny with big calves. You know, like, damn calf genetics.
And I believe sometimes maybe it comes from the geographical area which people, like a person grows in, because you know where my mother was born, it's like a very hilly area. Yeah. So my mother is from also a tribe that is thought to like have chicken legs, even in women. But you know, because of where he was living, because of the hills. Yeah, maybe from even the grandfather, the great grandfather and so on, the great grandmother, all of them used to walk on that hill. So I don't know, but I think maybe that somehow kinds of change your genetics. I don't know.
Yeah. You never know, because it's like a lot of bodybuilders here in Kenya from Western Kenya, because staple is, I guess, ugali and then maybe chicken or fish.
Of course, and the food.
Guys walk a lot, and so maybe obviously genetics has something to do with the geography. So you never know. I guess I'll probably have to move to somewhere with hills and see if this.
For the sake of your great grandchild.
Exactly. You started now.
Clear the calves, so
they'll
be okay.
So it will balance, yeah.
this would be for myself, for my.
Wallace, how did you get to where you are now with your gym? Can you tell us more about Hood Gym and your sort of your other talents? You build your own equipment.
That will go up to 2000 and I think around 2014, 2013, when I started working at the EA, there was a gym just behind Junction, Nakumat Junction, called the EA. So that's where I first got the idea of opening my own gym. And of course, I talked to my dad because he was into welding. And we used to make, the big stoves used in schools for cooking.
Okay,
So I used to help my dad in making those big stoves. And that's how I started. I learned how to weld. But I was not really into it. You know, when you are a young man and you're like, this job of welding is dirty. You don't want to do it. You know, you just want to do clean stuff and look cool. But my dad, you know, he was kind of strict, so I had to learn, and I really appreciate because of that.
Yeah.
So when I was at the EA, that's in 2014, and then after working for 3 years, I think I need something. And I first started with the weights, because I believe even up to now, the gym is all about the weights. Once you get the weights, then from there, you can start building. You start with the basics. And I started buying weights and putting them under my, I had a small room, so I was putting them under my bed, and I continued. I can remember even at that time when I was dating with my wife, she was like coming into my house, and I think she was a bit worried, what's this guy put under the bed? Because, you know, it reached a time the weights were so many that they were lifting, I don't know, the bed, the rays of the bed a bit. Yeah. So the bed is kind of tilted a bit. Yeah, because that's how I started. And then after I stopped working at the EA, I decided I was going to open the gym. So I just went in there, and I had saved a bit of money. So I bought a welding machine, because the one that my dad was using, it was mainly used for welding iron sheets, iron sheets, and those weren't as heavy gauge as the metal that I would need for building gym equipment. So I had to like go and talk to a local electrician to make me, to make me one locally that had a high volt for welding those heavy metals. And I started with benches and just the usual basic stuff. Yeah, and that was in 2017. That was the first food gym. Mm-hmm. So I built around maybe, I think 10 machines. And then there was a tragedy. So the whole place like was burned to ashes, everything. And the metal, the plates, like, that's why you see me all the time. I'm like, I like the heavy, the metal plates without the rubber, because, you know, those things survived. Yeah. And they didn't even lose, like, even just, even some points in weight. No, it's just the same Ivanko, 45 pound. Of course, I had some rubberized ones, but those ones, are, you know, I know, you know what happened. The rubber like burnt off. And the equipments, you know, when metal, like a metal tube is subjected to heat, it twists. Mm. See? Yeah. So all those equipment, all of them, they twist, they twisted. And I tried like, you know, hammering them back to how they were, but because of the weakness of the metal surface, when you hit it with the metal, instead of like straightening, it kind of, I don't know how do I put it? I mean, it goes in, when you hit it, it presses it, the place you hit, but yeah, not like the whole thing.
Yeah,
I don't know if you're getting me.
Yeah.
So now again, I was back to square one. I had stopped working. And I tried my best to not fall into a depression, but after a month, it kind of happened, by the way. I was just, you know, I stopped going to the gym, everything, you know. At least I had some friends who assisted me. I rented a house. And I don't know, I think Leon knows this, because, you know, where my gym is the same place where my house is, where my home. So it was my business got burned and my house, you see. So I was like, the only thing I had is the clothes I was wearing. And of course I was, at least everybody was okay. Nobody got hurt.
Yeah.
So yeah, you know, if it is property, even if you lose it, you can always gain it back. And I've already done that. Yeah, so after just like a month, I remember I was just walking somewhere, you know, stressed. And then I started feeling bad, like, you know, running out of breath, just out of nowhere. I was, I just decided, I was just going for a walk, but I decided to go to the hospital. And then the doctor checked, and then they told me I was okay. But then one of the doctors said he thought I was, maybe there was something disturbing me mentally.
Mm.
I was stressed. He asked me if there was something going on that could be stressing me. So I told them about what had happened, though I was still denying I can't be stressed, you know? That thing like you are a man, you shouldn't be stressed, you lift weights, you do HIT, you know? No, so, but after that, I was given some medicine, just to calm me down. And then they told me to go back to the gym. I went back to the gym. And after that, after a small donation, we started building our houses back. And as soon as I got my house and moved from where I had rented, I started now building the gym. Yeah, and now we are where we are now.
That's amazing. I mean, to come back from that is really tough.
Yeah, and I really appreciate, by the way, most of my friends came through and helped me.
Yeah.
No, even Leon himself, yeah.
I remember.
So I really appreciate you guys, yeah.
I remember you, it happened. I was telling Clea, and I'm like, then how you handled it? I guess maybe you were hiding behind, you know, but like how you handled it from there the next day. I think I've told Andy and Clea, and it was, I don't know if it would have been the same for a lot of people, but you were very calm, you took your time, you absorbed it slowly, and it was also for me anyway, it was a learning lesson. Like, yeah, you can always come back from Well, especially as you said, no one was hurt. So it was, it was a good lesson for all of us also.
I remember it was, of course it was a hard time, but you know, like I told you, those are the situations that, like, when you come out of them stronger.
Mm-hmm.
And you also appreciate whatever you have. Because you, I was, when the gym burnt, I was around 84 kgs. And I remember I had already planned to compete for Mr. Kenya. So after that, there was no way I could do that. And then I stopped training. I went all the way from 84 kg to 65. I just decided, for me, you know, whenever I train, sometimes it's hard for me to do something else as manual. So when I decided to rebuild the equipment, I had just like to put the gym and training on the side. Yeah? I didn't care if I lost, I became small. I didn't care. As long as I saw I was doing something else that was progressive and it was important for me, I was good.
Yeah, because I think also when was it? At EA is where you introduced me to HIIT and tried to murder me as I. So maybe you can tell us how you got into your HIIT, which, well, to this day, I'll not forget that first HIIT leg session.
Okay, HIIT, by the way, the first time I learned about HIIT, I didn't even know it was HIIT. And this is how it happened. Remember the gym I told you my dad paid for my membership there? Mm. There was this guy, he used to sell meat, beef, with a motorbike. And, naturally, the guy was like a slow talker. He did everything slowly. He lifted slowly. So me and my training partner, we used to train like 3 hours. We used to do like a lot of volume and volume and volume. And then this guy would just come in the gym, train like slowly. If he's doing like a bicep curl, it's like this, then slowly. He was just a slow guy, even talking. he used to tell me, Wallace and my training partner, Ash, Wallace and Ash, you guys, you are still training. I'm already done. You see, that kind of talk and everything he did was slow. So we were like, but he was big. That's the thing now. Like his arms, his forearms, his legs, everywhere big. So me and my friend used to think, this guy, the reason he's this big, because he sells meat and he eats a lot of meat. That's what we do. We were like, that's what happens. There's no way he can be this big because of something else and his slow training. And you know, because he was training slowly, the most he could do was 3 sets. Of maybe an exercise and he was done, do something else like that. But then we came to find out that the guy, he didn't even meet. He had like allergies. He couldn't eat meat, you know? And then he told us, you know, this guys, listen, this is how you should train. Of course, he was talking slowly. This is how you should train. Do this. Then we didn't accept. And I know it's the same thing with Leon, because I remember training you HIIT for the first time. Then you went and I don't want to do it. You know, it has taken years for you to start doing it.
We finished in 50 minutes and I'm like, what? I'm finished, but no. I need a pump and so same thing.
Yeah. Yes. So at that time, after I stopped, I was still working out in that gym. It's a small gym, just like the Hood gym, Gold's gym. It's called Gold's gym, but deep in the ghetto of Kawangware.
One of the in Nairobi for sure.
Yes. So when I joined, like I told you, I was in Form 2. But when I finished like Form 4, and then, you know, I had to try and do something to provide for myself, because like my dad was like, you know, you can't just stay in the house eating every 2 hours my food. Hey, find something else you can do. So he told me, he decided to take me to driving school. I had passed my exam, but he didn't have, I had a C+ in high school, but he didn't have the money like to take me to polytechnic, and I was kind of not really interested. So I started, when I finished Form 4, I started working as a bouncer. And then at around that time, I found there was a school for gym instructors in Kibera that was kind of assisting people who couldn't afford, like, going to college and so on. So I went, the money I was saving from my job as a bouncer, I paid there. I used to go there. We did like a course for 4 months for a personal training, for a gym instructor certificate. And at around that time, I got another job, because, you know, a bouncer is only over the weekend, on a Friday and on a Saturday. So I got another job. I was I used to work in a casino, a Westgate Casino. It was called Millionaire's Casino. So when I was working there, I couldn't find like 6 days a week to train and 3 hours like we were doing with my partner. So I could only train less, like come from work at around five, get into the gym 1 hour and leave. And all that time, in a matter of, I think, 4 weeks, all in my mind, I was like, man, the month I'll get a leave, I'll be training for 6 hours, because now I've been training for 1 hour or less than. But the month I get a leave, I'll be training for 6 hours. And then at around that time, when I'm within that 1 month, I noticed, you know, my strength started going up. And people in the gym were asking me, Wallace, hey, which supplements are you using? What are you eating? So I was like, hey, man. And then a few of them asked me, in fact, I even ended, you see, when someone asks you something like, you know, you are still young, you're like, now this guy is disturbing me now. Okay, you want to know what I'm taking? I'm taking creatine, I'm taking this. You see, because every time when you just, even before you start curling, hey, Wallace, hey, now you have grown big. What are you eating? They don't even ask the training also. And because that time I wanted to be out of the gym within 1 hour, of course I had to like make the exercise harder, squeeze where squeezing is needed and slow down on my reps, you know. And also at the same time, I was in training with my partner, Ash. So I used to train on my own. So there was no way I was going to load a lot of weight that I couldn't lift on my own. So I had to reduce the weight, you know, and train a bit lighter. And because I wanted to feel it more, I slowed down the rep speed. And then that's when it clicked. Wallace, man, you have been doing it all wrong. And I remember that time I had a lot of magazines for bodybuilding. They got banned when the gym banned, but I had a lot of them. So I remember when I used to read them and I reach a page by Dorian Yates and he's talking about one set. In my mind, I was like, this guy is all steroid. What is this? I couldn't even read. I didn't even read. I just skipped the pages from Dorian and go when I see somewhere Ronnie Coleman training by twice each muscle group, twice a week. I don't know, calf exercise by Schwarzenegger, 10 sets of standing, 10 sets of seated. Those were the exercises I was doing then.
Yeah.
You see, but now that it clicked, I've been doing it all wrong. I went back to those books. Now I started doing research about Dorian and everything about Dorian. You see, Dorian, and I learned a lot from there. Yeah.
A lot of people like that low volume training, but without the intensity now.
Oh, yes.
A lot of people want to do that, but forget the intensity part of that.
Yeah. Of course, like Mike Mensa said, you can either train hard or long, but you can't do both.
Exactly, you can't do both.
Yeah, it's like you can't sprint a marathon.
But but like Mike Mensa, well, he had an amazing physique, but even his volume was lower than Dorian, but I guess intensity was super high. But you look at his exercises and you're like, he's talking about 25 minutes, you know, 40, but I'm sure the intensity that went into it.
I think people don't also realize that Dorian had a couple of warm-up sets, but because of the weight he was lifting and the strength he had, those warm-up sets, the cumulative volume of weight involved is really high, even for his warm-ups, let alone when he starts adding in things like slow reps, iso holds, failure sets and all this stuff. You know, people just want to do what's easiest. And now we're moving on to this. Oh, low volume. I could do just two working sets. group, and that's it, you know. And people forget, actually, if you're going to do that, the intensity needs to be.
Even when Wallace was explaining, like what Andy has explained is exactly what, because Wallace is like, we're doing one working set after warm-up set. So in my head, I'm like, what are the warm-up sets? You know, like, I'm like, are you messing with my head? Like, I'm used to 5-6 sets, you know, of whatever I'm doing. And then Wallace is like, okay, that's warm-up done. Now we're doing one set and we're done. And I'm like it same thing Andy's saying. And I'm just like, one set. And so it's one of those, it's like, and what about the warm-ups? It's like, yeah, they count, but they're just warm-ups, you know, that's why. And for the longest time, that's why I think for me, hit, I'm just like, it doesn't make sense.
I've seen people be killed by Dorian's warm-up set. Like, Dorian did a warm-up set, and you see people thinking it's it, thinking they've done the work. He's like, oh no, working set next.
Yeah, he's like, now we're doing the top set.
Well, it does take, it takes a lot of getting used to high intensity.
I tend not to program it for that reason. Mm-hmm. I tend to, for general population,
Thank you.